Good morning, everyone. I am here today to present you a new package that allows the clustering of multivariate functional data. My presentation will be the following. First, I will quickly introduce you the topic, then the example that have motivated our project, and the package on its use on several practical examples. In 2007, the Gartner study showed that 8 billion of smart devices have been sold and that there will be more than 20 billion from now until 2020. Why there is so many smart devices? It is because the market is divided between companies with private solutions like electric connected meters or also security cameras, and also numerous practical applications for private individual, like health application, also used in everyday life, like smart houses, and also the use in different hobbies with smartwatches. All those connected devices collect more and more data, and also simultaneous variables for one individual. So there is an increasing need of methods to deal with those data. Smart devices collect continuous measurements. Those measurements can be seen as functional data. Functional data are data that can be linked by a curve, like for example here, the one curve corresponds to the temperature of one city along the year, or here we have the heart rate of one sportsman. The advantage of functional data is that one individual is considered as a curve and not as a vector of points as in multivariate statistics. And also that functional data analysis kept the dependency between points. But more precisely, what have motivated our project? As I said before, there is a coming up of a lot of applications in sports, like running smartwatches as the well-known Garmin or Polar watches. But there is also smart rackets for tennis and other applications in cycling and swimming. And me, I am working for in a company that works for equestrian sports. And since 2013, there was a lack of smart devices for equestrian sports. The only way sportsmen and riders and their coach have to study the performance is to look at the recording of the tour. That is why my company wanted to develop connected devices for equestrian sports, and more precisely to the show jumping discipline. For people who don't know the show jumping discipline, I will quickly remind you the broad line of this kind of sports. So in show jumping, a rider is timed on his course that contains 10 to 14 obstacles. First, the rider here has to check the distance between all jumps by foot in order to see the path he wants to take and which speed he will have to take between each jump. Those jumps are up to 160 centimeters high and 450 centimeters wide. And the riders are scored according to their penalties. So they can have penalties if a bar falls, if the rider falls, if the horses refuse to jump, but also if they exceed the time limit of the tour. In this kind of tour, the horse has to run around 6 meters per second. So it's quite important to the rider to know which speed he will have on all these tours. That is why Lim France Compagnie decided to provide a connected device that provides locomotion parameters such as the stride length, the speed or the frequency of the canter. In order to do that, we develop a connected saddle, which is composed of an accelerometer and a gyroscope in the front, in order to collect data in the three space direction. At the back, there is a Bluetooth antenna that sends the data to the smartphone of the rider. And we collect such signal. In blue, we have the acceleration according to the Z direction. And in red is the acceleration according to the X direction. With this kind of signal, we can, for example, detect the different phase of the jump. We also try to estimate the speed with an integration of the acceleration, but the accuracy wasn't satisfying. That is why we decided to develop mathematical models in order to predict the speed. In order to do that, we have to collect data with our smart saddle and video cameras that can provide the real speed of the horse. Like that, we have a reference database in order to build our predictive model. At the beginning of our work, we have seen that when we divide our database in smaller subgroups, smaller, more homogeneous subgroups, the accuracy of our predictive model was better because the speed of the horse depends on numerous parameters such as his weight, or also the breed of the horse. That is why we decide to develop a new clustering model that is more adapted to the data we collect, so to multivariate functional data. Quickly, the objective of our clustering method is to separate our 6 variate curves, because we have 3 acceleration and 3 angular velocities that are collected by the saddle, into K clusters. First, we have to reconstruct the functional form of our data. The one way to do this is to express our data in a basis of function. So each variable can be expressed as a linear combination of coefficient and basis function. Those basis function can be, for example, a Fourier basis if the pattern of the signal is repetitive, or it can be B-spline otherwise. Then, when we have reconstructed the functional form, we can project our curves thanks to a functional PCA in order to express each variable as a mean function on the multivariate combination of scores on harmonics. And then we apply a mixture model on those multivariate scores that characterize our strides. In our package, we have 5 functions in order to do all these calculations. First, we have the FunHDFC function, which takes as an input the data, univariate or multivariate. K is the number of clusters we want to look for in our data, and the initialization type of the algorithm. This function provides the clustering results, but also the BIC criterion in order to do the model selection. We provide a second function for model selection, which is named slope heuristic function. This function provides this type of graph. Here we have the model complexity against the log likelihood. This model complexity corresponds to the number of tested clusters. The red line corresponds to robust linear regression, whose coefficient is used to penalize our log likelihood. Then we select the number of clusters that maximize this penalized log likelihood. On this graph, it's the partition in 3 groups that is kept. We also have a third function that allows to do a functional PCA, multivariate or univariate. Another function to do the whole graph for this functional PCA. And to end, we have a predict function. I am not going to linger on this function now, and I will show you later its use on a practical example. So let's go back to the speed prediction of my horse. First, we cluster all our stride according to the acceleration, according to the z direction, and the angular velocity to the y direction into 2 groups. Why 2 groups? It's because we try several number of groups, and with 2 groups we have the best prediction afterwards. Then I apply a SVM model per cluster in order to obtain our speed prediction. And I do this multiple times in order to have an average percentage of errors. Here are the results for one simulation. We have here the predicted speed versus the measured one. The blue line corresponds to the first B sector. If our prediction were perfect, all the points will be aligned on this line. We can see here that we have some points that are bad estimated, and this plot is for the first cluster, and this one is for the second cluster, and that in our second cluster, we have a lower speed than in the first one. With this procedure, we have only 12% of error above 0.6 meter per second, so we are quite happy of this accuracy. Another objective of our study was to automate those calculations in order to provide this prediction to the rider. In order to do that, we will use the predict function. So we train our clustering model on our database, on our reference database, again on our acceleration according to the z direction and the angular velocity according to the y direction. Then when the saddle collects new data, data sent to our cloud, and then we only have to predict for the new data the clustering, and then apply the SVM according to the good cluster. In order to show you the other function of the package, I will switch to another example. This example is an extract from the FDA package. It's the temperature and pluviometry of 35 cities that are monitored for 1 year. And we wonder if we can see some groups of cities that look the same according to those temperature and pluviometry. So we applied the FNHJDC model on the temperature and pluviometry dataset, and we look for 2 to 8 clusters. Then we apply the slope heuristic model on our clustering. Again, we have the model complexity against the log likelihood, and when we calculate the penalized log likelihood, we can see that it's the partition into 4 groups that is the best one. And when I color my city by each cluster, we can see that the results are consistent with the geographical location of all cities. And more precisely, when we look at the data, we can see that the red cities that are here are the ones with the highest temperature along the year, but also the highest precipitation along the year, and that the black cities are the ones with the lowest temperature along the year and the ones with the lowest pluviometry also. Then we can also use our MFPCA function in order to look at the variation in the main sources of variation in our data. So we apply the MFPCA on both data sets simultaneously. And when we plot the results, one of the graphics that are provided that is provided by this function is the mean variation. Here it's the mean variation for the first variable, so it's the temperature variable. In black, we have the mean function, and in red and blue, we have the variation of this mean function. We can see here that we have the main source of variation is an amplitude variation between our 35 cities, and that this amplitude variation is also seen on the mean curve for the pluviometry variation. To conclude, we have developed a new model which allows univariate and multivariate functional clustering, whose paper and simulation are available online. We have also designed the R package, which is available on CRAN, and we are working on the extension of this model to the co-clustering, as I've presented Margot, in order to cluster simultaneously rows and columns of a multivariate functional dataset. Thank you.
So thank you. Comments or questions?
Hi, and thank you for your presentation. I have one question. How did you end up using SVM? Did you try other machine learning algorithm and you chose this as being the best one, or?
Yes, I tried several machine learning models such as neural networks or random forest, but we also try some multidimensional models like PLS and lasso models, and it was with the SVM that we have the best prediction.
Okay, thank you.
Other comments or questions? So I have some. So you have your real curves at the beginning, and then you say that you're projecting into a basis functions.
Yes.
So it's for taking out the noise, I think.
Yes. One advantages of expressing our data in a basis function is that we don't take it into account the noise, because another way to express our data into the functional way is to use linear interpolation. But in the case of you have a lot of noise in your data, it's a bit risky.
Yeah. Also, it's not sure that your time design is the same for different.
Yes.
Yeah. And so you're clustering the coefficients, in fact.
Yes, it's the coefficient of the curve that we cluster.
Okay, so do you take into account the projection? Because that means the norms on the coefficient is not the same as the norm on the curve.
Yes, in our algorithm, the projection is applied by subgroups. So first the algorithm, we have to initialize the algorithm, the partition of the algorithm. Then our curves are projected in functional subset space, one for each subgroup, and then we use the scores to do the partition. But I don't know if I answer your question.
That's fine. Thank you.
I have a related question on this basis expansion. So I imagine that the choice of the basis must be probably crucial for the the
yes.
rest of the procedure. So is it possible? So I don't know. As far as I understood, it's the user chooses a basis, or you provide maybe a limited choice.
Yes, it's a difficult choice in functional data analysis because the user have to choose the basis and also the number of basis function you want to use to smooth his data. And in my case, I try different, I choose a B-spline basis because my pattern is not repetitive for one stride. And I try different number of basis function, and I look as a compromise between the complexity of the model and the accuracy of the model. And I choose my final number of basis function like this. But in some other example, it's yes, there is not a straight rules about how to choose those two parameters.
Okay, so, and so could you imagine to choose them automatically because you have a prediction task in the end, so you could maybe incorporate this?
In my clustering model, I think it will be difficult because for me, I use it in order to have a better prediction after. But I think that some people will use this function as in the pluviometry dataset just to look at cities that look the same. So I think that it will be difficult to automate this choice because it depends on the question.